Okay, so since we had a break in between, I mean the weekend, so let me go back and recap a few concepts, then we'll come back to the original discussion that we are having. So what is this linear regression? So linear regression is something that will convert your equation into some straight line, I mean convert your data into some kind of a straight line equation. So you may have some, sorry, one second. So you may have some equation like this, y equal to 24x plus 5. It's a straight line equation. What we are doing with the linear regression is, you have some data. You have some data like this. Most of the times, the data will be forming straight lines. Okay. Now, what I'm assuming here is my data is kind of straight line, very close to straight line. So that is my assumption. Now, based on this, my data, if my data is fitting like this, something like this, what I'm doing is I'm drawing some kind of a straight line so that my straight line approximates my data. So using this straight line, I can try to find out some values which are not there. For example, let's say medicine equal to or drug equal to 50 grams. Maybe it's not there in the data. I can go and find out what happens when the medicine equal to 50 grams. I'll get the corresponding viral count on the y-axis. This will become viral count. So using this technique, what I can do is I can approximate what I can approximate the viral count data using any given drug value or the drug dosage value. So that is the idea that we started with. Then we realized the distance between each point and the line will become y minus y hat, because this line is nothing but y hat equal to beta naught hat plus beta 1 hat into x. This is the line we assumed. So there is beta naught and there is beta 1. If you find out beta naught and beta 1, we get y hat line, which means this line, every point in this line is having some y hat value. So y hat doesn't mean that there is only one value. At each x value, we'll have some y hat I, one point. So likewise, we have one y hat here. There may be another y hat here. So there may be n number of different y hats for a given line. Now, for every y hat, if I take a difference from the corresponding actual value, this is the actual value, and this is the predicted value. So if I have an actual value and a predicted value, if I take a difference, then what I get is an error. Now what I have to do is I have to minimize this error. If you go here, all I am doing is minimizing this error. But since, similar to what x minus x bar is, sigma x minus x bar equal to 0, y minus y hat is also equal to 0. That I have proved later. But this is also zero. So because of that, instead of minimizing the error, I am minimizing the squared error, square of the error. So that's why I'm using this. So using all these things, let me remove all these things so that your notes is clear. Using all those things, what I did is I did a simple derivative. using the derivative, I got two equations. One is sigma equal to 0, and another is sigma xc equal to 0. Sigma e equal to 0 and sigma xc equal to 0. Using both the equations, if you solve for beta naught and beta 1, you'll get these two values. One is beta naught equal to covariance of x comma y by variance of x, or another way to put it is sxy by sxx. Beta naught equal to y bar minus beta 1 into x bar. Using these two formulas, once we get beta naught and beta 1, we know that y hat equal to beta naught hat plus beta 1 hat into x. Now if you know beta naught and beta 1, and if you can substitute the x value from the data itself, the given data itself, you can do prediction for any y hat. Are you clear so far what we have discussed?
Yes, Sandeep.
And I have shown the corresponding calculations in Excel anyway. I have already done that. Then I also talked about the significance of betas. Actually, beta naught doesn't have much significance, but beta 1, it is more like if x is increasing by 1 unit, y hat is increasing by beta 1 units. Actually, this is a reason why it is called linear regression. The reason is 1 unit increase in x corresponds to a linear change of beta 1 units in y hat. These two are linear in terms of beta. Are you clear? X and y hat both are linear in terms of beta 1. The reason is 1 unit change here corresponds to beta 1 units change in here. 2 units change in here corresponds to 2 beta 1 units in y hat. Similarly, 3 units change here will correspond to 3 beta 1 units change in y hat. So y hat and x are linear using this beta 1 term. That's why they are linear. It's not because it is a straight line equation. It's much more than that. Is everyone clear?
Yes, sir. I understood.
So, for example, tomorrow I can write beta naught plus beta 1 x into x square. Instead of saying x, I am calling it as x square. Even then, I call it as a linear regression because it is linear in terms of beta 1. Are you clear or not? The reason is, for example, instead of x square, I can just replace with some k. Now y hat and k are linear in terms of beta 1. Even then I can call it as a linear regression with some exponential term. That is fine. So actually this equation really doesn't represent a straight line. It does represent some kind of a curve like this or something. Or maybe like this. I don't know. If you draw it, you'll know. But it is a curve, it's not a straight line. Even then, I'll call it as a linear regression. So that is something that many people will get confused. Linear regression is really not a straight line. Linear regression means that it is a linear equation. So ultimately, it boils down to having a linear equation. This is a linear equation. Are you clear or not, everyone?
Yes, Sandeep.
Others?
Yes, Sandeep. Fine.
Okay. No, that's what I was mentioning last time. And I also told that it works very well for interpolation, but not for extrapolation. All it means is, you have an equation like this and you have data like this, if there is some point, some x point where you don't have the real data, you can go and do an interpolation. Interpolation means within the data range that you already have. So if you do linear regression for this kind of point, which is a point that is within the range of the data that you have. When I say range, it is an X range. Range within the X coordinate. If you do that, then linear regression really works very well. As long as the errors are fine and linear regression satisfies some assumptions. I'll talk about the assumptions now. As long as the regression satisfies the assumptions, this interpolation works very, very well. But what about the range or the X range where the data is not available? So for example, in this point, for this point, there is no data available around this. So for this X point, if I calculate a Y hat, this may or may not be right. Okay. For this point, the Y hat may be right or may not be right. The reason is, so any two quantities might have a very complex relationship, not just linear relationship. But in this part, from here to here, we know that the data is having linear relationship based on the data that we have at hand. But after this, you don't know what happens. Maybe after this, the relationship is like this. I don't know if the relationship is like this after the data, after this point. So that's why we don't generally use it for extrapolation, but more for interpolation. Are you clear with the interpolation and extrapolation thing?
No, I'm not clear, sir.
I'm sorry.
So your meaning of interpolation is if you're able to predict data, what we've studied so far is interpolation, right? Because if you have a set of data and within the data itself, you're trying to find the predicted value of a particular Y hat, right?
Let's see this one. In this, let's say for this point, I want to predict, what is this point? X equal to 15, right? For X equal to 15, I want to predict. Now what I said is, this is interpolation. The reason I'm saying about it as interpolation is because let's consider the X range. What is the X range? It starts from here, X starts from somewhere here, and it ends somewhere here, okay? It may not be exactly the perpendicular line, but assume that it is perpendicular. Now, what I'm saying here, let's say this is around 2 and this is 25. So within a drug range of or medicine dosage of 2 grams or 2 mg to 25 mg, within this range, I can use any point. Maybe 15, for 15 grams, I don't have any data. Even for 15 grams or 20 grams also, I can predict some viral count. Within this X range, I can use it very well. Because I know approximately it is something like this, some straight line like this, approximately. I may not know the exact relationship between these two variables. Using the regression, I can approximate this way. But after this, for example, some point here. Thing is, I don't have any evidence.
Okay.
Ground evidence is not there. Maybe after this, it may be like this. I don't know.
Correct.
I don't know. So because of this, for extrapolation, in general, it is not safe to use unless you know it. Unless you specifically know that it will work like that.
Got it.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's what I meant. Okay. That's all we discussed until the last class. Now let's go into further details. Now before diving into much bigger concepts, let's go into a simpler, it's not really simple because it's going to take the entire regression classes, this one. But for now, it is a simpler one. Assumptions of linear regression. So linear regression only works very well when these assumptions are met. It won't work very well if these are not happening. So let me discuss about what are those. One is expectation of epsilon. What is epsilon? Epsilon is nothing but your error. I called it as an E here. You can also call it as epsilon. There is a small difference between epsilon and E, but that is not something that we'll discuss now. Okay. For now, epsilon and E are same. Assume that. Now, expectation of epsilon is going to be zero. And variance of epsilon, it's going to be some value called sigma square. These are the assumptions that we want to verify. We'll see how to verify later. But first you need to know about what are the assumptions at least. And epsilon i's are independent. Independent of each other. Which means covariance of epsilon I, epsilon j is going to be zero. If some two values are independent, then take a covariance between both the values, it should be zero. And that's what we have discussed from long time. Epsilon i's are normally distributed. Just remember these assumptions for now. We'll see how to evaluate later. I just wanted to keep it here. That's why I was talking about this now. Otherwise, we'll really have a deep discussion on this later.